Somebody missing other than Alan?
Adam is not in the job.
Is he not here?
And Karen is not in.
Can you increase the brightness?
The one, the top left, from the left, top left to the right, oh, my left.
Go back and hit your brains with you.
The ninth chapter, which is Synaptic for Advanced Applications. So up till now we have discussed about semantics and semantic web technologies, how it is helping for disaggregating heterogeneous data. But in this particular chapter we are discussing about an advanced situational awareness application with the help of mobile sensors and social sensors. Making machines to fit human environment instead of forcing machines to enter the humans to enter the machine environment. So he says that the best technologies are the ones that disappear and they weave into the human life. So this is about this introduces the concept of web of things, wherein everyday objects and devices, like everyday objects and things that we use, we interweave with the internet, collecting information for monitoring and controlling the human activities.
I will not discuss this in the context of web of things. I will discuss this in the context of what I call computing for human experience.
Yeah, so I'm saying that when here it says that the technologies, all the best technologies, they disappear. You're making the technology fit the human environment.
So you say that I mentioned this in this context of web of things. No, this context of...
No, I said this.
Okay.
This particular idea gives us the thing about web of things. This particular article.
So
this
that's not true.
Okay.
This particular thing gives us... it's a background for what I call computing for human experience. That is different. Internet of Things or Web of Things is things that are on the web, on the internet. That has, what does that have to do with the human experience or human activity? Indirectly, yes, but directly nothing. It doesn't say anything about it. So the point here is about, in all this, you know, future, because this chapter is about future, and advanced application, it's all about not focus on, say that we don't want to focus on technology primarily, we want to focus on, at least in the future, focus on human, serving human needs, improving human experience. What you could be doing, and in doing in such a way that it should not be technology-centric, it should not be that human has to be very good at using certain technology to get information, knowledge, experience in the sense of, you know, I'm in this environment, let's say. It should not be that human has to be right about that, and that this technology should be surrounding you, available to you as needed, essentially anticipating your interests or needs and delivering to you in a much more naturalistic way. There is an area called natural interfaces, for example, where people are trying to develop user interfaces that are not treated as knowing this, type this command, you know. So, you know, using, for example, just natural language is one example of that. When you talk to IBM's Watson, you are talking as if you are, you know, a doctor when he is, you know, interacting with the IBM Watson. He is interacting, or she's interacting, as if you're just talking to an assistant or advisor or helper, and not really, you know, worry about here, put this tab, you know, this thing, here tab, here menu, click there, there, that, none of that. So that's what we are.
In the, here we are discussing about, I mean, there are, in the real world environment, we have so many sensors that are continuously monitoring and sensing the activity. So here we have machine sensors and social sensors. So machine sensors can be anything like satellites, cameras, GPS, etc., which are sensing data like wind, temperature, precipitation, and collecting this kind of information. So these machine sensors are very objective. So they are defined to the work they are given, and they are very precise, and they are better than human perception. They are better and precise than humans. Whereas social data is, social sensors are something like Twitter and Facebook, where the, they're collecting information which is sent via SMS or tweets, for example. And these are contrary to machine sensors, which means they are subjective and they provide an overall picture of the situation, what is going on, and they do it quickly. It's they contradict the machine sensors, and so like this is one of the examples for. One more example for social sensor, like here I mentioned, I mean, machine sensors. Like all these devices are maybe put on the human body, where they're monitoring the human activity and collecting data of like pulse rate, temperature, and movement. You have a traffic flow sensor, which is continuously monitoring a traffic flow. Where if there's a problem with the traffic or slow moving traffic or at some place, the traffic flow sensor is monitoring that. And this cannot be defined whether it's caused due to a concert happening somewhere, or is it due to an accident by a car? But with the help of social sensors, we can know that by looking at the tweets, like using the spatio-temporal context, like if they're placed, traffic is happening at a particular place and there are tweets discussed about the same place, discussing that it's due to a concert, we can come to conclusions then. So we can say by this that social sensors and machine sensors are complementary. We need both to come to a collaborative conclusion. I thought you had. By integrating these two types of sensors semantically, we can get a whole picture of the data and we can get a complete story of what is actually happening. So these are like multiple ontologies which are used for different purposes. So the different type of ontologies here are sensor ontology, spatial ontology, temporal ontology, and domain ontology. And these ontologies provide the background information or background knowledge for the different kind of sensors like fixed machine sensor, mobile machine sensor. All these sensors are discussed in the next slide. So like for a fixed machine sensor, a sensor observation ontology gives the knowledge of what are the capabilities, it defines what are the capabilities of a sensor. And a spatial ontology defines the location of the sensor. So ontologies are required for defining what a sensor is capable or what is it going to do. So this particular information or data which is here is related to military context. It's discussed in military context. So there are these different kind of sensors which are present at that particular scenario. Like these are ground sensors which are provided, which are around the soldier, and these are UAVs, reporting observations, which takes an overall aerial information, or they collect the aerial information, and then there is the satellites, which are giving the spatial view, and then there are embedded sensors, which are on the body of a soldier, which are sensing poisonous gases or humidity, etc. So all these kinds of information are very, very useful when they are integrated together to, you know, maybe detect some dangerous situation or something like that. So all these information are provided by the background ontologies, which is location ontology, which is the spatial ontology, and time ontology is the temporal aspect, which defines at what time is the sensor collecting the data, and domain specific meaning the theme, like in this particular context the military theme. And sensor ontology can be defined by in this case SSN XG, which provides which defines what are the capabilities of a sensor or what is it meant to do. When dealing with machine sensors and social sensors, there are few disadvantages. Like when it comes to machine sensors, they are prone to environmental disturbances, and in case of social sensors, it can be just some rumors or any wrong information being provided. So dealing with this kind of heterogeneous data is a challenge, and there's no direct approach. So the trustworthiness of such kind of data collected from the sensors have to be improved, so that we can depend on the information that is collected by a sensor. For which, in case of sensors that are present in close proximity, like if a machine sensor and a social sensor is present closely at a close proximity, then we can exploit the socio-temporal context of it, and we can come to useful conclusions. But in case of thinly populated sensors, wherein they are maybe not placed closely, or if they don't have enough data, then in that case we need the use of background knowledge. And even when dealing with such kind of sensors, we also come up with the abnormal situation or unexpected data or faulty sensors. So in case of this, we should be able to easily differentiate between an abnormal situation and an actual danger. Like in case of freezing temperatures in May, it might be an unexpected situation, but we don't know. It can also be a fault of the sensor where it is struck at zero and it is showing a negative reading. So we should come up with robust sensors, but this can only be achieved by training the data. And then moving on to wireless sensor networks. In wireless sensor networks, the sensors are connected to these data sinks where the sense data is continuously offloaded, and these data sinks are connected to the internet and the data is being collected. But in case of unattended wireless sensor networks, these have to be called frequently by a mobile sensor and the data should be collected. So in that approach, wireless sensor networks require more power, storage, and security to hold the data intact, to keep it safe. But these kind of sensors are used in border crossings. So when you're doing it, when they are unattended, it is very much prone to things like tampering of data or irrelevant data. The consistency is not there. So increasing the consistency of unattended sensor wireless sensors, the use of RDIS, not wrong. Yeah, radio frequency identifications are used, which improves the consistency of unattended sensor networks. So right now, sensors have become a very integral part of the human life, and they're used for so many situations like healthcare, where it's used for monitoring human medical conditions. So one of the approaches for disaggregating the heterogeneous data that is collected is the bipartite graph. So this is an ontology. This uses an ontology, and here we can see this triple pattern being discussed, wherein disorder, causes, and manifestation. These are the subject, followed by a predicate and the object. So these are the possible symptoms like fever, headache, etc. So fever can be easily sensed by a thermometer, and we can come to conclusions whether a person is having fever or not. But for other things like stuffy nose, etc., it should only be given by the human. It cannot be sensed. So a person should be involved, so that we can come. So all these symptoms can lead us to confusions, exact confusions, whether it's a flu or a cold. So in this ontology, you can see that they have defined disorder as a as the object, as a type, and the manifestations can be anything like fever or headache, and they come up with a triple pattern as a disorder causes the manifestation. So, as we know, sensors are now being used to monitor and manage personal health. And in case if the absorbed signals are insufficient to come to good conclusions, it is necessary to diagnose them and go back. It is like a cycle where you should perceive, which is called as perception cycle, where it has to be perceived, come to conclusions, and again reiterated. So this is the general brief idea of how a perception cycle is, which is discussed in Deligo. So here, in this case, perceiver is a human or a machine, and something like a camera is a sensor, machine sensor, like the eye, which is equivalent to an eye. It's a machine sensor. So the camera observes, like in this case, this is the entity which we are trying to perceive. We are trying to understand what is this. So first, the perceiver sense focus, and the observer, that is the machine sensor, observes a quality. Like in this case, an apple has the quality of red. Redness is a quality. So this particular quality is sent back to the perceiver, and then now it sends another focus, like it tries to see the, in this case it tries to see that it is circular. So circular is also a quality, circular shape, it's a circle. So it sends back to the perceiver, and with the help of then with these kind of qualities, the perceiver can come to a conclusion that the entity is actually an apple. For which it requires a background knowledge, and these entities have qualities within them. So all these should be defined, by which a perceiver can actually come to a conclusion what an entity is.
So any question here? If you could get a sense of. Did you get the intuition? Really? What's happening here?
Well, one of the questions would be, how would you disambiguate between an apple and just a big giant red dot?
Yeah, I mean, the whole thing comes down to background knowledge, like what a particular entity, what all qualities it inheres. As I told, it's an iterative cycle, so every particular step after, I mean, it's not perceived at one step. Every quality is sent back, and it asks another question by which the data is retrieved. So, I mean, that's what I understand from this, that every time, I mean, every entity possesses certain kind of qualities. So, that's how.
Let me take an example that might help. Fundamentally, what we are trying to do here is, this is a quality of a real world entity. This is something that senses, observes it. And the point is that this is where we are trying to get a perception of, meaning understanding, a model of what is there in the real world. You look at an apple and something goes in your brain. Some set of neurons are fired that reach some understanding, a symbolic representation of what is there in the real world. Now, you take an example, let's say in the real world there is a blizzard. So, the point here is that the model of blizzard, so that you can describe something as a blizzard, would include typically visibility, precipitation, and wind speed. explain, visibility must be less than half a mile. Precipitation should be more than so many inches of snow or something. And wind should be more than 30 miles per hour or whatever the requirements are. And the whole idea of this environment is to say, how would you create an understanding from all the things you can observe? In this case, there will be multiple sensors. Sensor that measures precipitation is different than sensor that measures wind speed and so on, right? And the idea would be then that this thing, this process guides the process of creation of, that symbolic representation of whether something is a blizzard or not. And if, in the process of getting the blizzard, should, for example, it observe that wind speed is more than certain things, speed, then it kind of asks you to say focus, saying, oh, it will help me it will help me come to a conclusion it's a blizzard or not, based on additional reading of additional parameter. Okay. In addition, which not something that I can describe right here, but in addition, the work that Corey did also incorporates a method of focusing. So in this case, there are these three parameters. So basically, one can essentially model in computational terms a search space. All the values that this parameter can take, and in certain part of that space would be indicative of a blizzard. And the point would be that certain parameters are a lot more distinguishing for a particular perception than some other parameters. Maybe certain things are a lot more unique. That temperature, for example, may have the entire range, but the temperature may not really define blizzard as well as the other three parameters. And within the other parameters that I mentioned, visibility, precipitation, and wind speed, one of them also is a better indicative of that something being classified as blizzard. So by choosing the ordering in which you may seek out the information, you can reduce the amount of computation necessary to reach that understanding. Right? So just like in a database query optimization, right? You create a search space, right? And there is this general rule of selectivity, meaning you will first try and push the selection out such that you will have to, the amount of data on which you will have to, let's say, do more expensive operations will be fewer, right? So the same general principle whereby I would like to order if I have a choice, my observation of, because every time, if I have to get these three types of data, what is the order in which it might get so that I can read the conclusion better and faster? And so, and because as soon as I see that one of those is outside the parameter, I find out that, let's say, temperature, wind speed is less than 30 miles per hour, I know there's no need for me to get any more of the values for other parameter types. And so I can save the computation. All it takes for me to contact that type of sensors, get the data, and do whatever I need to do, right? So that is generally what we are trying to do with this particular thing. Now, if you sit back and kind of just observe what's happening, right? What's happening is an interplay between all the sensors out there, all the data that is there that are being collected. In fact, I can replace this physical sensor by a social sensor. Somebody sending a tweet telling me about the traffic jam or an accident on the road, right? So any type of sensory information coming in, and our understanding. So this is a mechanism to essentially reason. So we call this perception cycle, and this is a part of modeling of how would you do the reasoning such that you can take variety of signals and our sensory data and sensory observations and reach some form of conclusion in the sense of your understanding, right? And the understanding could be as in, you know, you see if these things are put side by side, meaning that I'm, you know, at the end of the day, my interest is to understand that this is an apple and it's a red apple, not green apple, right? But, and that is, you know, in human brain. And on behalf of human, this machine is trying to understand, right? Get understanding. At some point, by the way, which we are talking about here, there needs to be a transfer between a computational cyber world and the world of humans, right? Through some sensor, maybe this guy will speak out, I found an apple, right? Or maybe it will show you a picture of apple, right? Even though this apple is in another room, you say, oh, but all the sensors say that other room has an apple, and you know, there's a picture of it. So, yes?
So, machine also needs a background about it, right? Because in human, we learn all those stuff in childhood, like apple look like this. So, machine also needs a background.
Absolutely, that is what Nishita talked about, right? So, if you go, the computer is given, where is that? This is given this, right? Yeah. Which helps you. So, in the example of this one is an example of causality of symptom to disease. Similarly, you could talk about modeling of blizzard or modeling of understanding of an apple. So on. So, yes, that's a good point. So that's generally what it is. And but it kind of gives you a very powerful message. If you want to build this kind of system, it's hard to build without. Some form of knowledge. Now the knowledge can be encoded in many different forms. In the semantic web world, we try to use things like these ontologies. Even before there was something called semantic web, there were people used to encode it in the rules, for example. It's a form of modeling, you know, asserting certain things that when this is there, that is there, this thing. And so there are of course, trade-offs, right? How do you model the knowledge and how well you can discern and how efficient you can discern and all that. And although it's not a matter of this particular class here, but the argument is that we happen to believe in the research that we are doing and research that Corey has been doing and then Pramod Antra has been doing is that we have efficient mechanism to compute this using this kind of knowledge. Capture a lot of different kind of knowledge for a lot of different applications, and we can build a very robust system for reasoning or a form of reasoning called semantic perception. A very important part about this reasoning is that the idea for this reasoning is to convert large number of things that sensors see in the world into a few meaningful things that humans are interested in. To get inside, to make decisions, and so on and so forth. So we call this as a major capability for dealing with the volume aspect of the big data problem. Right. So in the big data, when we talk about it, and some of you are in this, like, you know, talk by the candidates, people have implemented a lot of way to efficiently process a lot of different data. And however, that data processing is all at the same level. When the data is after all processed and done, what you get maybe is a pattern, what you get is something relatively low level. What is fundamentally unique about our work here is that we are transcending the level of representation. You remember we are in this DIKW triangle, data, information, knowledge, wisdom, right? So we are, and we call this a vertical processing aspects compared to horizontal processing aspects. Today in that talk, there's a question about variety as a major issue, right? And their issue part, well, typically is that I have something on the road, let's say road, an accident on the road, and machine and sensor observes something and gives you some aspect of it, and social sensor, like somebody's tweet, captures something and gives you some information about that, right? And now both of these are about the same event, same situation, right? To say they are about the same means you have to handle the variety of sorts. This kind of stuff again is a very important thing. Here is that, hey, the amount of data that machines can collect is humongous. So Cisco, comes with an estimate that there'll be 50 billion Internet of Thing devices by 2020. Nokia had come up with some estimate there will be 40 billion mobile, sensors by 2015 or whatever. I forgot exact. Whether they say 2012 or 2015. I mean, nobody knows exact number, but this is really clearly in tens of billions, right? Few tens of billions. So the capacity to create all this data is massive. We know that there are more than billion tweets a week, right? We know that there are more than 350 million tweets a day, right? So the amount of data is all so much. But how much of that data is meaningful to humans to make the decision? Right? And that is, fundamentally what this course is about, what this book is about, what a lot of our research is about, right? So, and of course, that would be personal. What you are interested in from all the data is different than what you are interested in. So that would also be an issue, right? But the point here is, machines can go through billions of all these observations, right? I can have this cloud computation, this big MPI machine or cloud computing environment or whatever, and goes through lots of data. How much data can human consume in a meaningful way? We consume data at a high level of abstraction. When my brain recognizes this as a red apple, I'm really not paying so much attention to red and this shape and all that. I get that thing instantaneously as soon as I look at it, right?
Because you already know it before. If that is the first time you see it, you would not know it's apple.
Yes, there is, but the point here is that you want the machine to do that processing when all the data is being created and appears in the cyber infrastructure. You want the machine to do the processing such that it delivers you what you want to know. You don't want the machines to tell you the wind speed, blizzard, visibility, and precipitation. You are interested whether I would, it's a blizzard or not, right? So we are interested in whether it is what disease you have, or what kind of medical condition you have, not what your temperature says, what this lab test says, what this thing, right? That is a job today doctor does, but we want more. The point here is that ultimately the decision. Whether what treatment you will have, what drug you will give, will be based on that high level of abstraction that you have this particular health condition, not based on this little one data or this data or that data. Not, well, it may be more somewhat dependent, but largely speaking, it all is driven by the fact that, oh, you have this medical condition, these are the potential drugs. Under this condition, you give this drug and that kind of stuff, right? So, how many computations we can do, like mathematical computations, compared to machine, much fewer, right? But the level at which we can process is something the machines can't do, our ability to, and in fact, if you think about it, if you read a lot of materials, the material like that, there was a book that I have shared with you guys by this neuroscientist on the brain thing. Some of you may be aware of that book. I forget the name right now. The professor from UC San Diego, University of California, San Diego. So he's written, you know, exceptionally good, you know, work. We want to convert the data and deliver information or insights in the way that is meaningful to human, right? And so the point here is, our brain is not so good in doing the kind of relatively simple, computations, metric multiplication, or all those things, right? Our brain has an extremely well-corrected associative memory, meaning it is wonderful at firing across the neurons through the making connections. This is what I think a lot of people say. This is my belief also, and I think you can read, and some of you might have seen what I'm talking about, right? Semantics, relationships at the heart of semantic web, right? Some of you have seen that, right? The keynote that I gave in ER conference, for example, relationship at the heart of semantic web. Another thing we said earlier in this course also, remember, we said from documents to entities to relationships and events. We also drew the analogy, remember, Google is saying from strings to things. So they only made the first transition. And then if you read now more, earlier I told you what Amit Singhal has been talking about, more relationships, right? So the whole point here is that, our ability to incorporate the relationships in that reasoning is far superior than computers' way to do it in a contextual manner, using the background knowledge and all that. We want to obviously, this whole thing is to try and reduce what is called, there's a term called semantic gap. Okay, and you may want to look up this term and read about it. So the whole idea is to try and bridge the semantic gap between the physical world, between the computational world, the cyber world, and the human world. Right? All right. Any question? Yeah.
I just want to make my understanding more clear about this thing. So as you talked about the semantic perception and having the abstraction, I think it's more about application driven, applying this approach. So suppose our application is like the one you mentioned, that we just want to store from sensors when the temperature was higher and when the temperature was lower. So in this scenario, we actually know that, okay, we are really interested in high and low temperature. But suppose if our application is finding some facts out of a big data and finding some patterns out of it, then we cannot apply this.
Step back a little bit, and you realize that so-called application is our creation. You take application, file, or application. These are the things we created, folders, because we think that we can organize things using computers and communication technology better. To what extent your brain is compartmentalizing applications, as you may think, as in the computer applications? Right here, sitting here, you might, while you're talking, your brain may be even talking about, you're thinking about your parents. Right? So, I mean, that whole, the way, information is organized probably in humans is very different than the way we have created, we created a rather brittle structure. Because A, first of all, computers were a lot more brittle than they are today. But a lot of our paradigms are cognizant of the way computers work, what they can do and what they cannot do, and what we can make them do and what we cannot make them do. What I would like you to, what I would like to challenge you is to start thinking a little bit beyond that. That is the whole challenge of, that's what I would hope to challenge you guys by computing for human experience. Don't, you know, try to reduce thinking along the lines of course we're going to have to use computers and technologies to achieve our goals. But don't start with, you know, your, you know, training in the traditions of use of computers. Let's think out of the box. So, but that said, coming back to your question, we'll have to have some organization, whether you call the organizations by different applications, or you call the words by different context, or you case you can say by different relevant applicable knowledge bases. Any different ways that you want to talk about, you know, organizing your computation. Yeah, there will be some, you know, ways. But I have a thought, and this is something, again, this is not really a primary class, you know, issue, although you know, you can see that in a futuristic sense. We really need to come up with a more sophisticated way of thinking about context. Because whether the application becomes your context, you know, or whether context is on its own, this, you know, in the cyberspace, all the context that can be dynamically created, so that all the data that is, see, the data coming into systems are not, increasingly not so well defined. Earlier what happens is that I chose a specific sensor for a specific application, and everything from my, you know, my all decisions of physical world to the communications to the computing, this all were you know, scripted, right? So, for example, when Corey went to Tasmania and you know, during his internship in Australia, they have sensors for related to water-related issues. In, you know, Australia is has significant lack of water, for example. So there are a lot of projects with regards to water, and they also have issues about you know, this coral reef and water temperature going up, and you know, the pollution kind of thing are killing the coral reef. So they are, they have all kinds of sensors, for example, around this reef and measuring everything, right? But that whole thing, the whole issue is created for that application. Health of the environment, health of the coral reef and such. Compared to that though, what is happening now? Now people are, first of all, sensors are just put in for hoping to find something in future that is meaningful. And the sensors like these, our mobile phone, our humans, we have all these five senses, right? And our senses pick up a lot of different things that traditional sensors won't pick up. And that sensing also comes into the cyberspace that I can tap. That means I can now think about applications and uses that I have never thought about when this sensor is deployed. Right? When I get a blood pressure meter, or when I get, let's say, scale in our K-Health project, we have scale. When I get a scale, weight, right now we are using it for chronic heart disease, ADHD. But weight is very important for many, many other diseases. And health, fitness, well-being and all that, right? So once now there is a weight, even though I might have originally thought about the application of chronic heart disease, if the person is participating in the weight, he is now, he does not have heart disease, and yet to improve his fitness, it can still play a role, and I can use it. So increasingly, we are going to decouple the deployment of sensors, physical and social sensors, from the applications. Cars now come up with the sensors. And maybe initially the cars, the sensor will be used to warn you about, whether you're crossing the, lines on the road, or whether, the other, you're too close to other cars at the speed which you're driving, and so on and so forth. And then somebody will say, well, but I am going on traffic and we are a group of three cars. We're going to start using it for that purpose, for which it was originally designed. The sensor is there, data is there, I'll use it, right? So I think we need to, again, not think about, start to end in a scripted way, in predefined architecture and all that. Increasingly, have to think about these velocity aspects of it, the variety aspects of it, the things that, unintended applications and uses that we can come up with.
I just have one question. That, let's say the cars work, I believe that the result of, let's say, even something like the red graph like that, and then you predict, that is Apple. So very much in the background knowledge, you have all of the, let's say, all of the quality of what is Apple. But let's say in a broader scale, you have a lot of objects. And you may not have that, you may not have a complete description of all of the characteristics of the object that you need. So I'm wondering, how does it deal with the incomplete background knowledge in the case that you need to predict something?
No, it is absolutely relevant. In fact, whenever we talk about data and applications, incompleteness, inconsistency, and
uncertainty.
These are always, all there. Quality of data. These are major issues, right? So, what happens is that we start here. The data is, the knowledge is modeled using this OWL, which is a very limited language in terms of, so clearly, where do you model arithmetics? How do you effectively model arithmetic, for example? How do you, effectively model, for example, we had applications where we had to model arithmetic computations, and we have combined the inferencing, logic-based inferencing, with ILP, intelligent linear programming. So there is a paper that one of my students wrote, and we work on where we combine. So what basically will happen is the representation framework will continue to become richer to handle with these three issues. And correspondingly, computational issues will also continue to work on. Our brain is so much more, there's another aspect where humans are a lot more good at. Our guessing that we can do, right? Our intuition, you may call, right? What is the equivalent of human intuition in computers? Yes, but the whole point is that we'll be attempting to make computers powerful. So, for example, in Pramod's work now, who in every way is upon, he is modeling uncertainty, and maybe he will model fuzzy, other aspects of it, right? So, this will continue to do that. There are alternate ways where people also start to deal with this problem. So pay attention to, and on April 10th, when Chris Welty is here, and we talk about IBM's Watson, look at how they find ranking as a way. So there are many possible answers that are partial match, and how do you effectively rank and get the results? There's another way you can model without having to improve significantly your representation complexity. Right? So there are many options like that, and we'll have to try out different things and see which one works. Yes?
So they might put something to Shreyans and Ning's question. Because I kind of aware of this. So Shreyans' question was basically about this is there are like applications that is not these kind of things not applicable. So I would say any application, whether you deal with numbers and you do number crunching and all those things, basically let's say 80% of those things to try to come up with let's say patterns appearing in the data sets or some specification, right? So basically they are basically to come up with some abstraction. So the fundamentals of the framework is to come up with abstractions. The example given here is semantic abstraction, but I don't know whether you can call the identifying a pattern as semantic abstraction, but still you elevate the level of understanding, right? So basically the framework itself can handle such a situation.
So what if we have an application where I have some 100,000 or 10,000 cars number plate, and I want to find out the numbers over it and that kind of thing?
Well, that is not
this
framework is not for every computing application.
Exactly.
Right?
So, that's
so basically the idea is how to come up with abstractions from your data.
Yeah.
Right? So whatever you do, pattern recognition or classification, clustering and all those things, you try to understand things. Right? So basically to elevate your understanding. So the fundamentals of the theoretical aspect of this thing is to come up with the abstraction. So it's not number crunching.
And you can come up with abstractions only when you know that what kind of outcome you want out of your system.
Oh, I think this framework, it is applicable for like a very specific domain where you have like well-defined knowledge of like you have the knowledge from the expert or somewhere else, but it is not general enough for being applied to any domain.
So that's what I was asking, there's a line of things, basically
how to make sense of the data abstraction. So basically what Dr. says is the comprehension level of the human comprehension level, how to come up with that thing. So to add the real thing, when you have incomplete data, right? As a human, what you do?
Look up.
But still, you are searching for incomplete stuff, right? Let's say you don't have, you are offline. What you do? If you have multiple explanation, what
somebody
you? So basically, what I'm trying to say is like this framework is not going to. I don't believe that it is beyond the human abilities. So whenever we have incomplete information, what you give is multiple explanations based on what you have observed and what you know about, right? That thing this framework is capable of doing that, but it is not very well good at guessing things. Like whenever we have incomplete information, we can guess, maybe. It's still just a guess, right? It's not 100% correct answer. But whenever when you observe some data or qualities, then you can come up with some set of explanations. That is the best you can do with 100% accuracy. That is what this framework does.
But here we are expecting accuracy from this. We are not expecting explanation.
Explanation.
As a human, we are explaining things like, okay, there are incomplete data, so it might be this or it might be that.
Mm-hmm.
But here we are expecting final conclusion, not explanation.
No, but so Shani, in this particular framework, and it's an important point, just so that everybody is on the board, there are techniques and methods where they act as black box. So all the data comes in and tells you something, you know, that you can know about. And there are techniques which are more like white box, which will then where essentially you can provide explanation. This one actually is one which you can get explanation. It explains you why, how it came to the conclusion. On the other hand, if you were to use machine learning techniques, for example, neural network techniques, right, where you have a bunch of training data and you train the system and it gives a response. And once the once algorithm is trained, when you get new input, it will give the output. But it cannot explain why it thinks that it came to this conclusion. It's all in the, you know, statistical model that it builds inside. So actually this, because this is based on explicit knowledge and the reasoning, there is a possibility of doing explanation. So this one is actually suited for explanation. There are other techniques that would not actually be suited for explanations.
But in this case, like, as a leaf, apple as an image we have, right?
What?
Apple as an image we have, right? Like, through our sensor, camera sensor, we got the image of apple, right? And we can, via image processing also, we can compare, like, whether this apple or not. Because we got some data, right? It's a red color, we get all kinds of data, objects which are red in color.
Mm.
Then, through image processing, we can get it, like, whether this apple.
That is the next step. Initially, there's just an entity.
Yeah.
You don't know what it is. So,
like using some of the data which we filter out the data, and using other technology, we can come up with what kind of data it is actually.
So basically, the difference is what you do with image processing is you scan something and try to match it some other
things.
Here we try to comprehend like by what. Whatever we know, right, the knowledge is, that is the key thing here. By looking at the very, the qualities of the things, we try to comprehend them. In image processing, if you scan something, and if something else has the same shape, then it's done, right? There's no knowledge involved in that thing. But here we are trying to understand what it is, not just syntactic mapping.
Now, coming to the beautifulness of the system and application, yes, sir.
So, can we say that like there might be a chance that this machine or this conclusion can be wrong, and on the basis of incomplete data,
methods would compute a level of certainty, not this particular one. But there are, again, you can enhance this to tell you, I believe with this certainty and that may be tied to the quality of data you have. And more data you have more certainty. Here, for example, we have an application of this called that is where we take some sensors and put them on a mobile platform, a robot. And the robot goes near fire. And the system is there to predict the type of fire that is. And the point would be that you have information about carbon dioxide or monoxide and temperature and infrared signature and other things are measuring. And that different fires have different signature, type of fire, wood fire, chemical fire, all this stuff, you know, oil fire. And that they would try to the system would not be depending on if you have enough of all the information, it will be certain.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it can be this or that.
Okay.
So, this kind of computation can be done.
I think another interesting aspect of this kind of application is we can explain the observation that we got finally, right?
Yeah.
Rather than a machine learning or black box
kind of thing. Right. Right. Now, even then, there are certain advantages machine learning has on this side. So we may want to think about a hard problem. We think about how to combine best of both. Yes, that'll be. Yes.
All of a sudden, I have a question. I should have this before.
Okay.
What do you mean with the explanation?
Oh, in many cases, you want to know how did the system come to that conclusion.
Many cases.
You remember the previous talk, the previous discussion that we had with Hassan?
Hassan, yeah. The candidate that we had asked that question because that was machine learning and I cannot explain. So, for example, in chronic heart disease, doctor wants to say why we are building a system where we are trying to predict the risk the patient has or possibly being readmitted to anything. And with machine learning, it will not tell the doctor why it thinks that it's high risk. And, you know, it would be nice if we can tell why it thinks because of this and this and this. So suppose the high risk is elevated, because of a higher weight gain, then it's a doctor would probably give you diuretic that treats that problem typically with heart disease. The diuretic is a type of medicine that will, you know, take excess water out of your body.
Mm-hmm.
And we, heart patients are typically gain weight because of body retention and too much body water retention, and too much water retention can make you very sick very fast. But if, for example, heart rate is because the heart rate is very high, then diuretic is not alone. Right? So it's very important, in fact, and thereby. We were arguing that compared to that Wanda system that they have, where they cannot tell why. Now they will have to ask the patient or look up the raw data. While here we can tell without going to the raw data, the reasoning system can sort of directly tell you what contributed to whatever decision or the conclusion that was reached.
In some cases you're required by law. In that situation, credit card companies, if they deny your application,
mm-hmm.
they have to give an explanation for why.
Right. So that will be your So there will be this. Now, I just want to challenge you, at least those of you interested in this area, on Sujan made this point, or others also recognize that we here you have system is still somewhat brittle in the sense that you need the knowledge, and along that line it will be able to support some perception. What prevents us from building a system where, think of it as a basically a platform or a bus, and asynchronously new knowledge will be added, made available, and system will become smarter and will start supporting that. Right? So suppose, theoretically, I find some very good cluster on link open data nodes. I find that this is very good. That can be used as your background knowledge. This is not so good, so don't use that. And so on and so forth. But I go and I take many different forms of sources of knowledge and simply bring them in. And my system is able to have more knowledge. I mean, today, you take a course, you become very good in that, you are adding that knowledge to your brain, and you are supposed to be able to then, do things in that area of new knowledge that you gain from that new course, right? So our system can be, what is it that prevents us from making a system where we just add more knowledge? As we add more knowledge, it will do this and that and that. And the application can come out on their own way, and the system will say, well, I have knowledge, I can do it. I don't have knowledge, I can't answer.
That is what we did in the last 2 years. We didn't have the enough knowledge, and we built.
What you have done there is to build in a particular area.
Okay.
So what I would say is that we can even go ahead and not only about say cardiology or even healthcare, but now I start adding knowledge about fitness. I start adding knowledge about spiritual, well-being, whatever, right? And so I can.
You can adaptively, I just add, and with the application can adapt to understand that knowledge.
Right. So more knowledge I would have. More. So it's like I ask, question to Sanjaya, and Sanjaya says, "This I don't know." And but I may ask other question, then he says, "I know that, right?" So, if he has the knowledge, he will do that. And if he does not, he will tell me. So why can't we make the system the same way? That we'll keep on adding more knowledge, and we come up with a distributed architecture in such a way that just the same way that people can publish data on LinkOpen data, let's think the next step, where you can publish the qualified knowledge in some form that at least our machinery is able to do, and hey, continue, if you add more data, we will give you ability to do, this kind of application, this kind of questions you can start asking it. And if people do that, just the same way Wikipedia became a major resource for information, we can make the thing which we are doing at a different level, right? We are not just giving you information, data, we are giving you something more, right? So that thing, we can build that system that gives you the systematic perception kind of stuff over increasing amount of knowledge. So that would be interesting possibility that we have, that we may want to think about.
So that means the framework and the working model should be very generic. It doesn't, the dependencies among the facts or in the knowledge base is very less, right? Because of that, when you receive the new knowledge, the framework can understand not based on the existing knowledge, but on the new knowledge. So that means the mechanism must be very like something like domain independent.
You're right, but there will be all kinds of problems that will come. So let us say, for example, that there will be overlap, right? For a particular information, so suppose you want to talk about heart disease, right? There will be some part of knowledge, let's say, in the system that will help a few doctor make some decisions. And there's a different knowledge, a different level of information, vis-a-vis knowledge that somebody, you know, a heart patient can go and say, how can I improve my general health and improve, you know, my fitness and, you know, reduce my blood pressure, not through medical intervention, not through drugs, but some other means, right? And there will be a different set of, you know, knowledge that somebody else will create. Today, suppose you have a problem with your back, right? You can go to a doctor and you can try and get medication, or you can go to physical therapies and try and get something, or you can, you know, read on online and somebody will say, oh, there's a yoga instructor and, you know, yoga instructor can give you, you know, some exercises or, you know, yoga exercises that you can use to improve your condition. So what would happen is that in fact, it, by the way, reminds me of the work that a student of mine did in the year 2000, where we knew there would be many, many ontologies. So we implemented, I think this is the first work in my, so far as I can tell, in the world, where we did a search engine for finding the most relevant ontology for a query that you want to get answered. And then now, obviously, this, I don't know whether the similar thing can be, if there is any implication in finding linkable data. Aditya, I think, did the work on that a year or two later, you know, at UMBC on that topic. So it's interesting you put some seeds in. Yeah, go ahead.
Dr. Shek, you said that you add new knowledge into the system and then expect some intelligence processing. But let's say in the healthcare system, I put Barack Obama as the president of the United States into that, how does it help?
Well, no, it may or may not help, right? Because it may help because it may
some,
say Obama, there is Obamacare, and Obamacare has you know, benefits of pre-existing condition.
I mean to say something irrelevant.
No, in fact, that is the problem. Then the problem would be that when you add a new knowledge in your brain is extremely good at, say, you know, internalizing it. And merging it with all the other things you know. Either it knows when to compartmentalize it, saying, I got this information from this source and I trust it and I'll use it in this context, but not in this context. Right? In the trust example, we say the person, there's a person I can trust for giving me financial advice, but I will not trust that person to look after my kids. Very different, right? Different context you're going to make. So our brain is very good at making those distinctions. The analogy of that would be ontology alignment, right? You put a new ontology and you need to harmonize them, what relates to what and how, what is the same and what is different, which is a different problem by itself. So that is the problem that will come. If a problem was simply that you have really distinct sources of knowledge that you're going to put, and there is no, you only need one knowledge source or, at a time for one part of the reasoning, then issues are going to be easier. But as soon as you start adding multiple nodes, as you start adding more cluster to leak open data, you just put the data in but don't refine the relationship with other data sets. You're not doing very good, you know. You're not achieving full advantage. And in fact, you're creating problem because now you do a query on leak open data. I know which one I trust. I don't know. The same question will come here. So the problem of ontology movement is another sub-problem you have to actually solve, or make some assumption about it before we can go to a system that can have multiple knowledge sources and be able to reason about it, right? In fact, a long time ago, both, so when I used to work on federated databases, I'm talking about 1987. My colleague Jim Larson, defined a project and I kind of worked on it a little bit called federated knowledge bases. Federated databases, federated knowledge bases. And I also remember Geo Witherhold, another, very, very, he was very also quite ahead of his time, He also did some very wonderful work. People credit him for what the concept of mediator kind of stuff. I used to use word broker, he used mediator. But he had, I have some nice memory, walking on the beach of the 17-mile drive in, the Essimular is a very well-known retreat in California, Monterey Bay area. And so I remember, we had a workshop there and we were walking on the beach and we have a discussion on semantics and he is more senior to me and I was kind of my early days, so I remember him. Geo. In fact, I just while you're talking about all these things, so it was so interesting. This LinkedIn has this stupid thing called, people tell you somebody who doesn't even know you, that I know semantic web. So, I have some people, random people in the world, I know semantic web, I know NLP, I know project management, all these kind of stuff happen, right? So, most of that doesn't matter whether 100 people say I know this or not. Yeah. But it was very nice when recently Geo Witherhold and Mike Brody say something. Then I can say, I feel good about that. I can take that as a compliment, not just some random thing. They don't need any feedback from me. Maybe some students sitting in India saying I'm good at this, and then sends me an email. So anyway. All right, I think our time is up. We'll, continue in the next class, right? Hey, is it good, man? Before you go, I think so.